I want to introduce our next speaker. David Yerushalmi has been my legal partner in crime for a number of years now. He has defended me in a $10 million lawsuit that was filed against me in the Rifka Barry, if you remember Rifka Barry, the Christian convert out of Islam, one of the posters on one of the rallies. It's right back there on the right. He saved my life on that one, David. Because I insulted the Islamic supremacist lawyer who was defending her parents. I heard his squealings, you know. And David has been instrumental in historic wins for our organization against the city of New York, who is running anti-Israel ads. David will tell you about that fight. The anti-Israel ad is there. He is an army. He and Robert Muse have created the American Freedom Law Center, a new legal think tank for these very cases. They do our work pro bono, with the exception of out-of-pocket expenses. You want to write a check to somebody and make a difference? You write it to American Freedom Law Center. It is my honor to work with David and to be able to have him here speak with us today. Thank you so much, David Yerushalmi.
Good afternoon. September 11th, 2012, we're 11 years on. So before I begin, since we have what we would call a quorum of worshipers, to take just 5 seconds and say a prayer in your own way for the lost American souls. Amen. Say amen to all of your prayers. I noted that these were American souls. 9/11 is a solemn day of remembrance. It's not a day of polemics or histrionics, but it is an American day. One might want to share that with humanity or the other nations of the West, but it is an American day to always understand and appreciate that the freedoms and the liberty that our founders established here and the successors who fought the wars, who waged the battles in the courtrooms to establish free speech and the other liberties guaranteed by our Constitution, have paved the way for us, and we will, if we protect those liberties, pave the way for our children and their children. That is 9/11. I note that this is the Stop the Islamization of Nations first session of the World Congress Defense of Free Speech. I want to speak about free speech today in my brief notes, and I've shortened my presentation somewhat. As Pam noted, my partner and I, Robert Muse, began the American Freedom Law Center. It is a pro bono, national public interest law firm that engages in the protection of both religious liberty and freedom of speech, especially in the context of the battle we are currently in against jihad. Now, what's important to understand in this battle space is that all of us have to be clear about what we are up against. We are up against a doctrine, a political, legal, military doctrine and system called Sharia. What drives the jihadist, whether it was on 9/11 11 years ago, or in Europe, or tomorrow, or today, is a legal doctrine that requires them to engage in jihad, to murder the blasphemer, to invoke capital punishment against the apostate, and the list goes on. It just so happens today is the Free Speech Day, and I got over my BlackBerry not minutes before arriving a story from Reuters. Many of you might not have heard about it. Egyptian protesters scaled the walls of the U.S. Embassy in Cairo on Tuesday, 9/11, and pulled down the American flag during a protest over what they said was a film being produced in the United States that insulted Prophet Muhammad, witnesses said. In place of the U.S. flag, the protesters tried to raise a black flag with the words, "There is no God but Allah, Sikh, and Muhammad is his messenger," a Reuters reporter said. Once the U.S. flag was hauled down, protesters tore it up, with some showing off small pieces to television cameras, then others burned remains. "The movie must be banned immediately, and an apology should be made. This is a disgrace," said 19-year-old Ismail Mahmoud, a member of the so-called ultra-soccer supporters who played a big role in the uprising that brought down Hosni Mubarak last year. The article goes on. But what is interesting is the statement out of the U.S. Embassy, the State Department, immediately thereafter. The Embassy of the United States in Cairo condemns the continuing efforts by misguided individuals to hurt the religious feelings of Muslims, as we condemn efforts to offend believers of all religions. Today, the 11th anniversary of the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks on the United States, Americans are honoring our patriots and those who served our nation as the fitting response to the enemies of democracy. Respect for religious beliefs is a cornerstone of American democracy. We firmly reject the action by those who abuse the universal right of free speech to hurt the religious beliefs of others. There is nothing more anti-American and contra the U.S. Constitution than that official government statement I just read to you. First of all, there is no such thing as far as we are concerned. People can have their own individual beliefs, but as Americans, as a universal right of free speech, the free speech right that we rest upon is uniquely American, and it is by law as well, and it is emboldened and held in trust by the First Amendment to the United States Constitution. You can go anywhere else in the world, and I guarantee you, you can go to England, you can go to Europe, anywhere else, and you will never find a First Amendment right as we have. I have the right to insult any religion. I have the right to be civil or not. If an individual wants to stand up and attack, I don't even know what the movie was that insulted Muhammad, but if an individual wants to stand up and exercise his free speech right and say that movie is insulting, improper, that is a perfectly appropriate expression. But for the U.S. government, when the United States flag is being ripped down, to apologize not as if we have anything to say about free speech, but to apologize for movie makers in the face of that kind of attack is beyond the pale. Now, I just want to make a slight correction, and that is, while you can go to Europe and they are being attacked and arrested, the fact is, right here in this country, free speech is under the same kind of attack. I want to come back now, and we'll get to that, but just to the notion, Professor Mordechai Kedar flew in from Israel, and he was my co-author in this study. Back in 2006, when everyone was speaking about Islamic extremism, radicalism, there were several individuals in this field, national security, public policy, Stephen Coughlin being one in the military, who were focusing in on the threat doctrine. You don't have to talk about Islam as a theology or a pietistic expression of someone's reach to the trend, to the divine. But if you focus in on what drives the jihadist around the world, speaking different languages, coming from different cultures, having different victimization narratives, the one common denominator is Islamic law. Extant, authoritative Islamic law. What Mordechai, Professor Kedar, and I decided to do here in America was to send researchers to 100 mosques throughout the United States that were representative of all the mosques here. Those researchers went in to measure the Sharia adherence of the mosque and to measure as a dependent variable the call for violent jihad in those mosques. Lo and behold, what we found, and you can see the ultimate finding here on the screen, 51% of U.S. mosques and texts that either advocated the use of violence in the pursuit of a Sharia-based political order or advocated violence, and 30% had texts that were moderately supportive of violence. 19, less than 20%, had no violent text at all. What does this mean? It means that in the United States, institutionalized Islam, not Islam that's practiced in the hearts of perfectly patriotic Americans, but the institutionalized version of Islam, embraces the Sharia, which is no different from the Muslim Brotherhood or Al-Qaeda. Now, as a matter of free speech, getting to the topic of today's Congress, I've been working since 2006 until 2010 tirelessly with others in this field to move the political discourse and the policy discourse from radicalism, extremism, into one that understood that the threat doctrine that motivated all of that was Sharia proper, extant authoritative Sharia. We had not, didn't have a great deal of luck. I published law review articles, essays. The study that you saw in 2006 was finally published in 2011 by two peer review journals, the Middle East Quarterly and Perspectives on Terrorism. But all of that work came to naught. We were really beating our heads up against the wall. Then one day, a young lady, happens to be one of my favorite clients, wanted to run this ad on the MTA buses. The MTA rejected. The controversy that stirred, somehow, and I don't know how it happened, somehow generated that the discussion was about Sharia being practiced here in New York or not. Now, whether that was a rational discussion, I can't say. But all of that work that we had been plowing the fields for all those years, suddenly, as a result of Pamela's and Robert's work at FDI in opposing the Ground Zero Mosque, Sharia became the center focus of everyone's discourse. Ultimately, thank you. I'm going to run through these quickly. Ultimately, we sued the MTA, and before we could even sit down in the saddle to ride that horse, the MTA threw their arms up and said, oh, it was all just a big misunderstanding. Of course we're going to run it. And they ran it, and the publicity and the advertising value of the controversy was, of course, far greater than the ads themselves. Another event was representing Robert and Pamela in Detroit. They wanted to run this ad, "Fatwa on your head, is your family or community threatening you, leaving Islam?" And the Detroit bus line SMART, it's an acronym for something that is not very smart, decided not to run this ad, and we sued in the federal district court in Detroit. It took us a year. We had a full-scale evidentiary hearing. On cross-examination, I was able to get the representative of the SMART Transportation to essentially agree with us that there was nothing wrong with this ad. It wasn't too religious or too political or anything else. They just didn't like the fact that, you know, it was Pamela Geller. A year later, the court ruled in our favor and granted an injunction. Immediately, SMART took it up on appeal, and the court didn't rule on their motion to stay the injunction, but still, the ad didn't go up. And we recently had an oral argument before the Sixth Circuit. And let me tell you what the government agency, argued before the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals. I think Pam was there. They stood up to the podium as the appellant and told the court, the problem with this ad, Your Honor, is the fatwa. Everything else is okay. But the word fatwa is a big problem. Why? Because it's based upon Sharia. And Sharia is not religion. It's a legal and political doctrine and system. And I said, finally, the U.S. government, at least in Detroit, understands what Sharia is. It's not religion as we understand religion. And I don't deny that there are plenty of Muslims who practice Islam as a purely pietistic, First Amendment-protected religion. But Sharia is not. It embraces law, politics, military, ritual, everything that is important to an adherent Muslim, according to the Sharia doctrine, is covered by Sharia. We're now waiting for that opinion. We expect it soon, and we anticipate winning. We came back to New York with this ad. Mm-hmm. In any war between the civilized man and the savage, support the civilized man, support Israel, defeat jihad. Now, I've read this many times over. I happen to think it's a great copy. And I always tip my hat off to Pamela Geller because she knows how to prick the beast.
She's good.
I'm left to defend and fight off the beast as it's battling, but it's a joy. I can't find anything wrong with that ad, not factually, not civilly, not in a civilized fashion, but they did. And the problem, again, it's always one word. The problem was savage. Anything else was okay. Of course, I had argued before we filed our lawsuit that all Ms. Geller is saying here is that if you're engaged in violent jihad, murder of women and children, then you're a savage. And if you have a choice between defending one or the other, you defend the civilized man and not the savage. They didn't like it. So we sued. Thankfully, we got a young, new judge to the Southern District of New York, Judge Paul Engelmeyer, very sharp man. And who boned up on the First Amendment, and after a full evidentiary hearing again, ruled that the MTA's provision that did not allow for demeaning speech was unconstitutional, violating the First Amendment. And he said, you're out of your mind. He said, this is the First Amendment. This is the First Amendment about political speech. This is the most important right we have. In our First Amendment jurisprudence, when the government takes away your right to speak, it is irreparable harm, and it can never be fixed until the obstacle is removed. He gave them, finally, only until tomorrow. So by tomorrow, we're going to know, you can all check Atlas Shrugs, and find out if they did anything. I haven't heard from their lawyers, so I doubt if they have. That ad will be running, and of course, the storm that will follow will be international.
Yes. Yeah, we will.
Happens to be anyone who's concerned about the feelings of Muslims would have thought that this was far more offensive than the savage civilized man ad, because it speaks directly about an Islamo-realism. Well, the fact is the Friday that the judge issued his opinion, this ad went in for a final decision, and they just gave up. They ran the ad. Now, here's where I come back to a cliff. We don't have to go to Europe. Sharia is dangerous to the United States for two fundamental reasons. It has the doctrine of jihad, which is a doctrine of war. But it also has a doctrine of jihad which is stealthier and which seeks to impose Sharia values on everyone else in the world. Where do you see that? Well, you see it in the OIC, the Organization of Islamic Conferences, Cooperation, which is simply a sovereign group of smaller sovereign Muslim nations that are attempting to impose their version of free speech, You can talk freely, you just can't insult Islam or Muhammad. They are pushing that through the UN, through treaties. If the United States were to adopt that, and the State Department's getting dangerously close, the next question for the United States Supreme Court, and this is why it's so important who the president is that it's appointing justices, is going to be asked this. Does the First Amendment trump a treaty? Well, it says in the United States Constitution that a treaty has the force of supreme law of the land. And that question hasn't been fully adjudicated in our jurisprudence. And it's one that people are beginning to talk about, but it will be the next great battle space in this area of free speech. Well, I was going to run the video. I'm not going to. But what you'd see here at the end of the video is a bunch of Christians that we represent was at the Arab American Festival in Detroit. And they were just there peacefully preaching, talking to the young men. They had a camera, thank God. And there was a group of them talking, and it didn't come close to a disturbance. You can see it on the video. Well, at the end of this video, the police come up, having been notified by the security of the Arab American group that was running this festival, and they were arrested for disturbing the peace and other type of similar crimes of that nature. My partner, Robert Muse, represented them in the criminal case, took it to a jury, and won an acquittal. 2 weeks later, we filed a 100-page civil lawsuit against the mayor of Dearborn, the police, and everyone else, including the Arab sponsors. Again, I have a video, but right here in America, this year, that Arab festival was last year. This year, a man down here by the name of Reuben Israel went there again to preach the gospel. Now, granted, he was there to really preach the gospel. Acts 17 that went is there to talk. A lot of them are former Muslims. Reuben Israel went to preach the gospel. While he was there, and many of you have seen the video, if you haven't, you can go to American Freedom Law Center's website. They were pummeled by rocks, water bottles, cans, cartons, bloodied for simply preaching on a public street, a forum that is the most protected area for free speech. The police came to them at the end, you can see it in the middle here, and he said, either you leave or you're arrested. And Reuben Israel turned to the police officer and said, but one second, we're the ones acting lawfully. Why aren't you here to stop the individuals who are committing the assault? Police officer simply said, you have a choice. Notwithstanding the fact that you live in the United States of America, you're on the streets of a city in Michigan. People are literally attacking you with weapons. If you don't leave, you will be arrested. Well, we now advise our clients, because we don't like going through long criminal trials, we'd rather just sue, walk away. He did. And we're now preparing the complaint against the Sheriff's Department for their despicable behavior in this affair. I want to close with this. We're here to protect free speech. The speech that we all engage in to criticize Sharia or Islam or Jesus or Judaism, or Ronald Reagan, or Barack Obama, or Mitt Romney, is a precious right. But it is not a right that will remain in this country as long as Dearborn, Michigan can engage in that kind of behavior, as long as the State Department can issue statements of this sort. One organization that we represent, and I represent a lot of organizations in this field, one organization that has done more to exercise that free right, to do it at the margins, but to do it civilly, and to protect the free speech of everyone in this room and everyone in this great country is American Freedom Defense Initiative, Pamela Geller and Robert Spencer. So while I will not turn away contributions, the first check always has to be to the work that they're doing on the ground. We'll be there to defend that right. But without clients like Pamela and Robert, we have no one to defend. Because the number of individuals who are prepared to be attacked in the way that they have been, the way that all of us in this field have been, but especially Pamela and Robert, the number of individuals that brave and that courageous are few. Most of them are overseas serving in uniform. Thank you very much.